Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Kimberly Cloud Show. I'm your host, Kimberly Cloud. Wow, I am live. So I am live on KCAA and StreamYard, which I thank. Facebook, I always thank. LinkedIn, YouTube, Twitch, and Twitter. I would like to talk about my past, present, and future. I got less than 54 minutes. I wanted to saturate the Californian audience with my past, my present, and my future. Okay, where do I begin? It wasn't easy for me growing up as a poor child. I grew up in Charlotte, North Carolina. I actually was born, let's go from when I was born. I was born at Greater Southeast, Washington, D.C. And that's in Southeast D.C. And my dad moved down to Charlotte, North Carolina, where my mother decided to move down in Charlotte, North Carolina. Now, she struggled to get us good education. And some things I'm not so smart in, but some things I am. But she struggled to get us education. And from the fourth grade above, I went to Billingsville Elementary School, where it was hard. We stayed in like the projects area, and it was hard for me growing up. And I just could remember being beat up, you know, having conflict every day. I played the violin and the cello. I was able to relax my mind. I was on television one time in Charlotte. I don't remember which, I think it was Channel 9 News. And ever since then, I wanted to be on TV. I used to watch Sailor Moon, if y'all know what Sailor Moon is. And I enjoyed watching it. And I enjoyed being productive, you know. So then I went to Stop Charlotte Middle School, and it didn't work out. I couldn't read music. I had a cello, and I couldn't read the music. But I learned from harmony. I learned from the sound, like drumline. I learned from the sound of the music, but I couldn't read it. And my mother would go to the school board almost every other year to vouch that we should be put in a better schools. And so we ended up going to a better school. And she moved to Kannapolis, Salisbury, in Concord, North Carolina, which is 30 minutes to 45 minutes away. And she decided to homeschool us. Now, my sister, you know, I don't want to dig into the past about her, but she didn't want to be homeschooled. But me, on the other hand, I loved the reading and learning. I had to teach myself math. And so we ended up moving back to Charlotte. When we moved back to Charlotte, I sat up there, and that's when my mother found out. I was working at the Winn-Dixie. The Winn-Dixie is a grocery store in Charlotte in the Southeast States. And I sat up there, and when I was working at the Winn-Dixie, my mother got sick. She got sick with cancer. She was in her fourth stage of colon cancer. Now, they tried to cut out some of her intestines, but it grew back rapidly. So she ended up passing away. I ended up walking in 5 minutes after she passed away. Now, I tell you, that was a very horrific event. And so all the aunts and uncles came down, and they were arguing, where are they going to go? They can't come here. And then all of a sudden, they sat up there, and I went with my Uncle Joe, RIP to him, and my sister went to Hawaii with my Aunt Pearl. And so when we went there, we split up, and I ended up going to Oxon Hill. So we were in Oxon Hill, Maryland. I ended up going to Oxon Hill High School. I ended up testing at a ninth grade and 12th grade level. But in order to graduate with my class, I had to take seven classes. for 2 years. So I took 7 classes and it was crazy. I had my own vehicle, my Honda Accord. I got my license at 15. I took learner's permit. I got my learner's permit at 15 and my license at 16. And I had my own Honda Accord, 1990 Honda Accord. That was my first car. And then I'm not going to speak about nothing bad, but it was dire circumstances that happened. And I ended up going to the military. Now, in the military, I got an honorable discharge. I learned life lessons, and I wasn't the courageous. I was a courageous soldier, yes, but I wasn't the perfect soldier. You know, I didn't earn any awards or push myself or motivate myself like I could have. And so then we moved to after, post-military. I ended up for 2 times working at Convergys, not 2 times, but 2 places. Affiliates of AT&T, working at Alorica and Convergys. So I worked at Convergys first. In Convergys, it was hard for me. It was very, very hard to sit up there and have this job. You know, hi, thank you. Welcome to AT&T, where we specialize in expertise. How may I help you? You know, like saying that every day, you know, going through Snooper and all those 7 systems. It was crazy. And I stayed there for 2 years. And then I said, this isn't really going well for me. So we ended up moving, me and my first husband ended up moving to Hawaii. I started working out every day and took care of my children. And what else? Went to school. I went to Hawaii Pacific University at the HICM base, where I was specializing in sociology. I went to Japanese tea ceremony. That was such, like, I'm still trying to get those pictures off of MySpace today. I can't get them off of MySpace because MySpace is stalled. Their system is stalled. And so after I sat up there and was at Convergys in Alorica and went to Hawaii, I sat up there and moved again. And I moved back to Baltimore. Baltimore, Maryland was where I got everything done. I sat up there and I went to Baltimore City Community College and got my degree in human services. I sat up there and used to catch the bus. I got a joke story for you, but I used to catch the bus every day in the rain, in the snow, the bus to school, traditional 16-week school. And I didn't have perfect clothes or perfect hair. I just went because I wanted to do more with myself. And I would spend hours up at night just studying. You know, I say it's a lot harder for your associates and masters. So I would stay up, bachelors. I would stay up hours of the night just studying and listening to Taylor Swift, Blank Space. And so the joke goes like this. I lived in the projects. I was on Section 8. And I sat up there and I was sleeping one day. Well, when I first moved in the place, it was a beautiful place. When I first moved in a place, it was beautiful, it was nice, you know, whatever. And I started seeing these little dots around. This is a joke. This is a joke for all my people out there that understand the struggle that women get messed over sometimes, you know, single women. And so I sat up there, right? And I started seeing these dots on the on my tables. And I'm like, where is this coming from? Where is this? So I wipe it back up, leave out, come back, and there'd be like dots on the table again. So I was like, oh my God. So the joke goes like this. One day I was asleep and I heard something. I heard something rattling. And I was like, okay, is somebody trying to break in? And so next thing you know, this big old rat jumped up on my bed. And I jumped off the bed in a hurry and I fell and I almost broke my back and I could never find it again. And I moved out. I ended up moving out within a month. The landlord was like, we don't have rats. We have field mice. I'm like, no, that is not what I saw last night. So yeah, it's a big rat problem in Baltimore. If you don't know Baltimore, Baltimore downtown, the specialty places, they had a rat problem. It's everywhere, in the good places and the bad places. So I moved to Reisterstown Square Apartments, still going to school, just switched to Coppin State University, where I got my psychology degree. And I got my psychology degree. Oh my God, it was so hard taking that one class that everybody hates. It's on the tip of my tongue, statistics. Oh my God, statistics. Like psychology statistics was so hard. And I stayed on top of the teachers. I went to class every day. I love learning. Even if I'm not listening, I love to be in that environment of learning. And so then during that time, I got money back from the military because they changed my other than honorable, because I wasn't the perfect soldier, to an honorable. They didn't change it to a general. They didn't change it to nothing else but an honorable, because what happened to me in the military was wrong. I won't get into the logistics, but the Army Review Board, I owe it to them in Arlington, Virginia. So I got like $180,000 back. The first thing I did was bought me a car and bought some other things. I bought me a 2020 Chevy Traverse. I love that car. Oh my God, that was my baby. And then I put $10,000 on a business and called it Blue Cloud Cleaning Company. So Blue Cloud Cleaning Company consists of me going to commercial, not residential, but commercial cleaning businesses and cleaning their plates. And I would sit up there and clean, and I enjoyed it. I had like maybe 3-4 contracts, and then I started gaining more contracts. And after that, I ended up moving from Mountaintop after the year because of dire circumstances. And I was alone because my second husband did something horrifically and terribly to me. And I won't get into the logistics, but I was on my own. And I moved from Wilkes-Barre, Tennessee to Philadelphia, the most terrible neighborhoods I was in. I had to trade in my car for a Chevy Malibu. I traded in my car for a Chevy Malibu, 2021 Chevy Malibu. And I was just driving and I ended up in Philadelphia. I was in Southeast, Northeast, Northwest, Southwest. I was all over Philadelphia. Now, the first day I got there, I tried to get help the VA healthcare services there did not treat me well, because when I went there at 8 a.m. I drove 2 hours, 8 a.m. I went there. I was beat. Now, I was so beat. And I went to social work, the social workers, and I spoke with them, and they were like, okay, well, come on in, get your bags, and we'll house you. This was at 4:30. I was there the whole day trying to find social workers and people I can talk to. Well, what happened was, I got there with my bags, and then the head of the social worker department called me and said, no, you cannot come, take your bags and leave. I said, well, where am I going? Where can I go? I said, my husband and I split up. Where can I go? And they were like, we don't know, but you need to leave. I didn't do nothing. It's on camera. Everything I said and did was on camera. And this is all documented, by the way. From the moment I went to the emergency room to the moment the security guard told me about a shelter in the most dangerous neighborhood ever, where they gave me a mat that was 3 feet long and they gave me a blanket. No blanket, just a mat that was 3 feet long. People looking at you, you know, wondering if you sleep. I had two cell phones and a MacBook. I wasn't going to sleep. So case in point, I was up since 8 o'clock that morning, and I drove back to the VA at 4 a.m. So I went back there and some chaos happened, and I tried to take it to the news company, but they wouldn't take the story. They wouldn't take the story on it. And I'm not going to name the news company because they didn't know me. I'm not mad at them for that. And so after Philadelphia, I stayed at one more shelter, a battered women's shelter. And when I stayed there, it was one day before I was flying out to LA. And before that, guess what, y'all? I forgot the most highlighted portion of my story. I sat up there while at this battered women's shelter. I spoke with Damon John. Damon John from Shark Tank spoke to me for 3 minutes about my business. And, you know, they look at people. They look at where people are located. They're not just going to pick anybody. I was just liking his stuff because I understand what his perspective on what business. There was over 2 million people listening to him, and I got to speak to him. So, you know, I kept myself busy throughout shelter to shelter to shelter, where you sleep and there's gunfire, you know, for no reason, you know. And so the day before I left, you know, I ended up flying out to LA, where the VA in LA sent me to Santa Maria. Now, let me tell y'all about my accomplishments there. I won't talk about nothing bad. So I stayed at a shelter there. Yes, I've stayed at shelters. But this is the courageousness of my story. Like I said, I am not privileged. So the shelter I stayed at in Santa Maria was a good shelter. And I sat up there and got my own place. I got my own place, and I ran for U.S. Senator. I ran for U.S. Senator, and I used to go to Jamba Juice all the time. My routine was to the T. I would wake up, go to a high school before all the students arrived, watch the sunrise, go to Jamba Juice, go back home, interview people, and do it all over. And go to school. I was at the University of Phoenix, too, because I'm going for my master's in business administration. So it was some conflict. It wasn't perfect. I've talked about it over and over and over on my show, on my documentary. And after I sat up there and ran for U.S. Senate, things started to go downhill. Like, for instance, I was had a meet and greet, not in a good way, by the cartel that wanted me dead for speaking my mind about what's going on in America. That's what I would do. And I had some other issues, but it's okay. The highlights were I got to meet the mayor. I got to meet the great people, the police officers of Santa Maria. I will always be indebted to them. Some of them, like 1%, no. But the 99%, yes. They saved my life. There were illegal immigrants trying to get in my house. For instance, one day I woke up because I used to smoke cigarettes, and I walked downstairs and there was lights everywhere. And I walked outside and there were 10 police officers that shot an illegal immigrant. They were right at my house. He was just going like this with the blunt object, and they shot him and he ran off. And I didn't see him die, but I know they shot him. I know what a gunshot sounds like. And so, yeah, like that can scar a person for life. And so I didn't like where I was anymore, just like Benny Johnson didn't like how he watched somebody get shot. If y'all don't know who Benny Johnson is, he's a journalist. And so I ended up moving to Salt Lake City. No better. But the before I get to Salt Lake City, the mayor greeted me with a certificate of appreciation. And then I had my banner put on the rim on top of the post where everybody can see it when they went around the roundabout. And so I appreciate Alice Patino. Her name is Mayor Alice Patino. And and that's, you know, she's a courageous woman, you know. After that, I went to Salt Lake City. I left Santa Maria, went to Salt Lake City. I had my own place. And I just continued to go to the University of Phoenix, trying to get into different programs. I was able to mentor somebody. I almost got on the news in Salt Lake City, but it didn't, Utah, it didn't work. So I said to myself, what can I do to help alleviate therapeutically my life? I said, I want to travel the world, but the money I have costs too much to stay on Section 8. The money I have cost too little. And so I didn't know that. I wasn't thinking straight. I was just so wrapped up in what was going on at the time, which was they migrated to Salt Lake City. So I wanted to go to the UK, and I really wanted to go there. So I ended up going to Boston, Massachusetts? No, it was Denver, Colorado. I got to see the Rocky Mountains. I got to see some sights. I ended up going to the Rocky Mountains, where I was able to, resonate with Don Denver. You know, Annie's song, I played that as a child. You fill up my senses. Yes, I love that song. And so after Denver, I went to Boston. Oh my God, do they have accents in Boston? I spoke to a police officer there. His accent was so crazy, yo. I just got off the airport and like I stayed at the I stayed at a good quality hotel and I met this young whippersnapper and I'll never forget her, man. I enlightened her, man. I gave her good advice. And so from there, where did I go? from there I came here, I believe. And then when I got here in Seattle, no, I went to Ketchikan, Alaska. Never forget it. Ketchikan, Alaska was the most quietest, wonderfulest place. It's the first city of the first state. And it wasn't snowing in. I know it gets crazy when it snows. And it's one way in, one way out. They have Homeland Security. They have a Navy base. And I bought some boots. I'm looking at them right now. I will never give up those boots. She gave me a good discount on those boots. And it gets crazier. So they suggested, the lady at Alaskan Airlines suggested I go back to Seattle. So I went back to Seattle because I had to fly in from Boston to Seattle. And then I went from Seattle to Ketchikan, which is an island. It's an island. You have to fly through water. I rented a car, which is pretty cheap. Y'all should check it out. And I used to sing. I go on the outskirts and sing. You know, it was because I wanted to be in that Alaskan part where all the aliens were. That's where I wanted to be. Nome, Alaska. So I would just sing. I love to sing. And when I flew back to Seattle, I was homeless again. Money, but homeless. Had money, but homeless. And I was so mad. I sat up there and went to the VA where they helped me out. They gave me some gift cards. And then it happened. I went to the, I won't say the name because they actually helped me. They helped me get into this place, the another sector of the YWCA. I'll say their name. But the YWCA downtown, they had some eccentric people there, I should say, that put methamphetamine in my tincture and caused me to be aggressive. Now, this caused me to end up getting arrested. I've never been aggressive to the point where I have the police attention. I've never done that before. And so when I went to jail, I spent almost a year in jail. And then I got out and I said to myself, you know what? They duped me. They duped me with this methamphetamine. What do you think is going on with our children? What do you think is going on with people that don't know methamphetamine is being administered to them? I want to run for state senate. I want to run for state senate this time. And this is the story I told the executive director of the Republican Party, which he and I have a meeting on March 1st. And so I was like, I can't do this no more. I'm like, I can't go from shelter to shelter. They use drugs. I've seen so much chaos at shelters, using drugs in front of children, doing all types of stuff that's illegal. And now they got me in trouble. So what happened was, right now, I am currently at the University of Phoenix, and I am running for state senator, and I'm going to help wipe off the methamphetamine out of Seattle. There are only 8,000 police officers to 8 million people here in the state of Seattle. That's not a good look. And it's not a good fit. Because in New York City, there was gang members that jumped NYPD officers and they let them go. Like, I've never had so much of a parking ticket. And I forgave myself, you know, and I really want to create a better atmosphere for the children of tomorrow. If they are around nothing but drugs and crime, that's going to make them do the same thing. It's going to be a repetitive behavior. One thing that my brother said that rang true was break the chain. Break the chain. And that's what we got to do. We have to start breaking the chain of everything going on. Because if we don't, it's going to get worse and worse. Now, I'm not saying that I'm anti, Anti-Mexican. I do like Mexican. There are some good Mexicans out there. There are, and I've met them. But the illegal immigrants that are coming over by the boatloads and gangs, like I said earlier on my show, you may not think that you're being watched, but you're being watched. You have to have a heightened sense of urgency. A heightened sense of urgency. And what I mean by that is you go to a store. Some people walk all the aisles and somebody can be following them and they not even know it. A white woman running every day at 5 a.m. at night before day broke. An African-American male raped her and threw her in a trash can. I say that's not right. That is not right. Alan Kelly, a 73-year-old white male, God bless his soul, is locked up in California when he lived in Arizona for shooting, never shot nobody his whole life, shooting and killing a 48-year-old illegal immigrant walking across his territory. A black male strangle another African-American woman. We have enough crime over here that we're trying to detain in the state of New York. And they let him go. And then he did it again. And the FBI arrested him. This type of stuff I talk about. Now, Toastmasters, I have a problem with speaking in public. I can speak in front of a camera on a laptop all I want. But this is new territory right here. I have to debate some highly educated people for the spot at state senate. And I'm willing to do that because I feel like I deserve to not BS the people, but actually make a change. I'm tired of people getting in office saying that they're going to make a change and people are dying every day. People's cars are being broken into. I see the news every day. And I'm thankful that I'm kind of in my house right now and I don't have cable yet. The police are burnt out. They have to choose between what emergency to go to. Gas prices are high. Almost $5. They were in Santa Maria when the gas prices started rising and inflation started happening. They started looking for the double digits. They started posting the double digits. What are we going to do about the crime? A bullet has no name. I still condone weapons, but it should be, I don't see it the same way because I see that there should be a crackdown on ordering weapons. I met a guy, this is what I mean. Like, I met a guy that had weapon parts sent to him and he put them together. And I couldn't say nothing. What can I say? What can I say? Don't do that. He said in his ways. And it's like, I don't want to be in that life. I don't want to be in that life. You know, I've met my brother. My brother used to, before I went into the, I'll tell you a story and then I think I'm closing, but I'll tell you a story. So there was, before I went into the military, I was on delayed entry, if y'all know what that means. Delayed entry is when you delay getting into the military. And I was 18 years old. My brother done some messed up stuff to people. And karma came back to him. He used to sell drugs, and I was staying in the projects until I can leave Charlotte Boulevard Homes in West Charlotte. And he ended up getting shot in the chest, and I'm the only person that saved him. He was calling my name, and had I not gotten up, he would be dead. That would be another family member that's dead in my life. And I went downstairs, I called the police immediately, I helped him, and now he has a half a lung. And this is what I mean, crime doesn't have a name. And I have reason to believe, you know, I'm not gonna snitch on nobody, but I've been around people that done some messed up stuff, and I had to be around them. It's not that I wanted to be around them, it's that I had to be around them because I lived with them. That's not the life I want. I want to live in middle class. I want to have my own house. I want to keep my own brand new car that I have, which is this year edition. I want to do good, not only for myself, but for the community. I want them to see my progress. I want them to see the dedication and determination I have to get my degree, which is going to be in January. I'm going to fly out to University of Phoenix to graduate. Then I'm going to take a year off and go for my doctorate. Go for my doctorates in business administration. The Kimberly Cloud Show has came a long way. I haven't even told y'all about my businesses. Real quick. So when I got Blue Cloud Cleaning Company, I also created Genuinely Michelle Wigs. Now, I ended up going on PA Live. Yes, that's PA Live. I managed to talk to some producers. This is my first time on TV. And I went to PA Live with Haley, and she interviewed me. Now, I had some terrible looking wigs. I had the best wigs at my house, but since me and my husband split up, he locked the house and I couldn't get in. So I had to find some quick, cheap wigs to put on there. But, you know, practice makes perfect. And this, I tried my best. Then I had Wigs for Success Incorporated. I wasn't able to get that off the ground either. And now I have the Kimberly Cloud Show. I have the Kimberly Cloud Show where I interview people about their past, their present, and their future. I love interviewing people. We had a little malfunction earlier. I was supposed to interview Mr. Paul Barron, but it didn't work out. I have to choose another date for him. But I would like to reiterate to Mr. Paul, if you're out there watching, I had to do this show because this is what I do. I couldn't stay and try to help you with the statistics of sound check right then and there, because that's why I invited you 15 minutes early. I'm not bashing you. You're a wonderful guy, but this is business. It's business. So yeah, I do like and enjoy what I do. I like interviewing people. I am going to get put in I'm in the magazine, but I'm gonna put my classified ads, my business classified ads in the magazine, New York Post and the Tennessean newspaper. For Nashville, that's what I'm gonna do. And so pretty much it goes like this. I sit up there, I'm building, I have a couch coming tomorrow, I have a bed coming tomorrow, well, Thursday. I'm gonna get like a set of pots and pans and stuff and get my house together. That's basically what I'm working on now, you know, and then going to school. I go to school, like I said, at the University of Phoenix. And what I like to do sometimes from time to time is put my schooling onto StreamYard and stream it. That's what I do. And I've been creating, trying to create reels and trying to create things for Facebook, like Facebook ads. That way I can keep an organic audience coming back and forth to me. That's what people do. I'm about to start running. Once I get my ID card, my Washington ID card, I am going to start running ads for running for state senator. And I'm going to start going to remote locations and filming myself with one of those stands and filming myself talk about running for state senator. I'm going to get basic channels. I don't want cable because it doesn't interest me. I lived with cable and it doesn't interest me, but I want basic channels where I watch nothing but the government channels and watch the government, C-SPAN. That's my niche, C-SPAN. I love to watch it in the government. And so that is basically it in a nutshell. I'm a basic person. I was proud of myself for getting my degree in psychology and graduating in Baltimore at Cobb State. I was proud for getting my degree at Baltimore City Community College and graduating from BCCC. I was proud from graduating basic training in the Army. That's not easy. Some of the stuff was hard to do, but we did it. I look forward, nothing but love to all my drill sergeants and nothing but love to all the police officers out there that risk their life every day. Every day, they risk their lives. It's not an easy job. They're burnt out. Like I said before, they have to figure out what emergency to go to. They have to figure out which emergency is more emergency. So, they're burnt out, period. Like some people say, F the police, but without the police, we wouldn't have law and order. The FBI, 35,000 there's only 300,000 police officers in the United States to almost 400 million people. 35,000 FBI agents. 35,000 just in the main FBI sector. I commend the FBI. I commend the FBI on catching bad guys. I commend them. I commend the CIA for doing what they did because I had to write the FBI and I had to write the CIA throughout my course of going through what I was going through with the cartel. I literally saw guns in their hands and they were coming towards me and I had to call the police. The police was there so fast, so very fast, and they scouted the area. So I know what it's like to be in a situation like this. And I still almost get followed from time to time, but I know what to look for, the symptoms and signs and what I did and how I can remove myself from the equation. And it seems to be working. So far, so good. I have no issues. I know it's not perfect, but I have no issues I'm complaining about. If something looks weird, I'm dialing the police. The Renton police, the Auburn police, excellent. Excellent. Seattle police, excellent. They do what they can. And that's why, they're underrated, I feel like right now that there should be more benefits for them and there should be more dedication and figure out ways that we can make a better cohesive. We need to put more money instead of defunding the police, we need to put more money into the police. so more people can come on a force. That's what we need to do. That's what we need to do. You suffocate somebody, they're liable to go to the other side, the bad side. And that's something we don't need or we don't want. You pay somebody a low pay. And I got five more minutes. You pay somebody a low pay, they're liable to do some corrupt stuff. So, you know, once again, my name is Kimberly Cloud, and I have the Kimberly Cloud Show LLC. I just got my 5 minutes to talk. I'm ready. I just got my LLC. It'll be here on Friday. I got my own business banner. It is amazing how the Kimberly Cloud Show is getting so much greater. Like, seriously, I could have so many stars on. Like, for instance, I had DC Glenn on. Boom, there it is. DC Glenn. I had Steve, ex-NFL player Steve Harper. Yes, I've had some people. And I believe his name is Will Roberts. He worked with Brad Pitt and Christopher Nolan. I'm trying to get him on the show. I don't know if that's going to work, but I hope to God to get him. If you're out there listening, Will, I love you. I hope that I can get you on the show here, you know, at KCAA. You know, we want you, you know, we want to make your show the best show it can possibly be. And I have two other, one is from Fit Bootcamp, and the other is a famous comedian. Check out my page, y'all. Let me give you my hashtags before I end. So we have Facebook, The Kimberly Cloud Show 39. We have Instagram, The Kimberly Cloud Show 39. We have LinkedIn, The Kimberly Cloud Show. We have YouTube, The Kimberly Cloud Show. We have Twitch, The Kimberly Cloud Show. We have Twitter. It's not the, but it's KCS Experience. The KCS Experience 84. I am willing to interview you guys if that's what you want to do. I appreciate all of you Californians for listening to me. I love you guys. I remember I watched something real quick. I watched something from Santa Barbara, and the senator there, she was like, make it rain. They were doing something. I love news, regular news. And she was like, make it rain. I was like, you go, girl. You know, I love women. You know, I love women. I got to say, you know, I appreciate them. Their artistic work. We're hard workers, man. And I can't wait to be around some good senators. I cannot wait. And this is awesome for having me. So definitely, y'all take care. I hate leaving. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday. So I love you guys. And next week, we're having a wonderful show next week. And I have some people I have to interview on my show at 3 p.m. So y'all take care. Be safe. Thank you, KCAA. I have to say thank you for making my show possible. Y'all take care. Affiliates of NBC. Yay! Take care. Bye.